Ladies and gentlemen, Dennis Miller.
Thank you. That's very nice. That's sweet. Thank you. Thank you. Just, thank you. Very nice. I'm just working fame like a pommel horse. I used to be here in Chicago. I was just in Las Vegas. I went to see Celine Dion perform, because you know it ain't over till the thin lady sings. I've never lived in Las Vegas before, but I believe years ago I had relatives who lived there and worked in the sequin mines. Much like the Persian rug makers, the Las Vegas sequin applique artists like to deliberately weave one flaw into each pattern because they too feel that perfection is solely the realm of the creator. Just like to dig a little esoteric hole right up front to test myself. Might have overshot. Might be in a bathysphere at the base of the Marianas Trench. Might have inadvertently redug the hole attempting my verbal escape. Actually, I'm in a great mood tonight. We had a big week in the Miller family. My 12-year-old son, Holden, got his black belt in Taekwondo. And yeah, very proud. Big moment for the Miller clan. Up until this point in history, we've not been known as a particularly motivated brood. Did a little research. Our family crest has a channel flicker on it. If I appear a little off my feed tonight, you should know that earlier today I had a colonoscopy done in the IMAX format, and now I've got David Brashears and Tenzing Norgay IV lodged in my duodenum. Don't worry, I don't know who they are either. Actually saw a couple films today. Saw the Bob Crane film, Autofocus. Creepy, huh? Willem Dafoe is Christopher Walken before he had water. And I saw the new James Bond film, Die Alive Yesterday and Tomorrow Again. And I liked it better than the last one, Born Yesterday to Kill Again, Tomorrow Forever. Finger. Oh, this India-Pakistan thing is really heating up. I had no idea how bad it was. I'm watching Johnny Quest the other day, and Haji's game is way off. I mean, he was in a two-shot with Bandit, and they flipped it to shoot the Bandito's reverses. The Hodge splits and lets the second AD feed him the lines. Yeah, it is that bad. Oh, what if those crop circles are just ads for Target? Just flicking the jab here, trying to see what you're about. I was listening to some of my son's rap music the other night. I believe the artist was Large, Small, or Biggie, Medium, something like that. And I remember thinking I'm so out of touch with the African-American cultural experience that when I got into town the other day, I went immediately to Borders, picked up a copy of the autobiography of Malcolm the Tenth, and yeah. Trying to do my part. Went to the post office yesterday. The post office is now beyond slow. It's inert. The Wilford Brimley on 33 and a third look-alike behind the counter went into the back room, which, by the way, must be a fucking time-space portal. He was then able to Fitzcarraldo my registered letter out to me in a mere 8.5 minutes. You know, ironically, in a highly driven culture, it would appear the only people not interested in pushing the envelope are postal employees. Also went to Circuit City. I'm wondering if Circuit City can possibly make their receipts just a little longer. Because I'd like to jelly roll Cleopatra up in one and present her to Caesar. You know, you can encircle the globe at the equator with 4.5 Circuit City receipts. Speaking of wasted paper, I got 7 Victoria's Secret catalogs in the mail this week. You know, if I got 7, I assume most of you got 7. What a massive waste. You know, never in the history of the planet has more actual wood been felled in the pursuit of figurative wood. I'm out of the self-pleasuring business now. I'm so put off by my expanding middle-age waistline that before I masturbate now, I first have to slip myself the date rape drug. I come from a simpler time when Palm Pilot was a nickname you received upon entering puberty. I was way beyond Palm Pilot. I was the Palm Chuck Yeager. Tom Wolfe wrote a book about me called The Right Hand Stuff. I think I was the first kid in my grade school hip enough to go to the European grip. I don't even actually own a Palm Pilot. I don't know about you. I find technology a little spooky. I find it depersonalizing. I remember thinking that the other day as my son and I were playing a Nintendo 64 game of a father and son playing catch. Oh, well, I'll make it up to him. We're going to read Charlotte's website together. What else I did today? I went to Blockbuster, bought 3 DVDs, and then from noon to 4:30, I opened them using only an X-Acto knife and a Jaws of Life I borrowed from a local ambulance team. You know, it's now actually easier to break into films than it is to break into their packaging. We love our entertainment, don't we? And more we seem to get it from the news. We have become a nation of peeping Tom Brokaws, a culture that thrives on projectile gossiping. And to be truthful, it's all voyeurism cloaked in the guise of a democracy's need to know. I remember when voyeurism used to extend to watching your neighbors play naked scattergories through their semi-open Levalor blinds using nothing more than a 3.5 EQ refractor telescope equipped with infrared cable. Well, maybe I've said too much. My favorite newscaster is Sam Donaldson. I think Sam allows me to multitask. I can stay informed and watch Star Trek reruns all at the same time. Sammy, that is a funky coif, my friend, huh? That rug could plink a cop killer bullet. I think the most aggravating news story in the last year has to be that guano brain chick who got caught slapping her kid around on videotape. What a zipper head, weapons-grade stupidity, and yet she's sentenced last week under misdemeanor guidelines. It's unbelievable. I wish they'd start trying these people in big cities. I don't trust small-town justice anymore. Call it my mockingbird intuition, but I don't think I've ever seen a wise judicial decision come out of any courtroom that has a ceiling fan in it. What else do I like to watch on TV? I like to watch the Christian channel and try to figure out who was raised Christian and who just did so much blow they had to convert before they blew their head off. I was raised Catholic. I went to confession the other day. I said, you first. I knew the Catholic Church was in trouble when I saw the Pope wearing his mitre sideways like a rally cap. And I've never trusted priests. I don't know about you, even as a young kid, I remember I'd say, hey, what's his deal? No chicks, no cash, ever. Oh, what could go wrong there? No, that's a sound decision for a 19-year-old, really. Then the Catholic Church has the gall last year to get all the bishops together in Dallas for this Latter-day Concordat of Erect Worms, where the boys try to decide how many kids you can do before you get drummed out of the core. You know something, when I was 12 years old, they were adamant about the fact that if I had a hot dog on Friday, I'd end up around a campfire with Pol Pot and Hitler, yet all of a sudden everybody's a little murky on the fucking rule book, huh? You know, some of these guys actually even belong to the organization NAMBLA. Do you know this group? It's the true group, the North American Man-Boy Love Association. It is unbelievable. We should castrate these sons of bitches, turn it into the North American My Balls Lack Attachment Society. You know? They won't even have to change the letterhead on the stationery. I'm always thinking about the other guy. NAMBLA. Can you believe it, huh? What's it coming to, folks? The world is so ass backwards right now, it almost makes you wish you were dyslexic. And you know, Psycho Central has to be the dementia cul-de-sac known as the Middle East. Listen, I know I don't speak for everybody. We all got to go on our own way on this one. Indeed, this war could happen in the next couple of days, but I think we got to get in there right now because it's only going to get worse, and I think it's time to start kicking ass and taking hyphenated names. You know something? I know. I know. I know it's not for everybody. We're all rolling the dice. Nobody really knows what to do. But I'll tell you one thing about force, a periodic show of it. It works. Has anybody seen Gaddafi lately? Of course not. We stepped him down. We put the tetch on his bean. Fired a missile into his pup tent around 12 years ago. He's sitting there in the early evening on those poobah pillows. A little warm breeze in his face, anticipating a little Gunga Din Din. Maybe some hummus s'mores. Sees that tent flap rustle, thinks it's his 8 p.m. Baba Ganoush shake. All of a sudden, you got Wile E. Coyote coming through on an Acme firecracker. Yeah. Now that'll get your attention. Gaddafi's now considered to be the moderate in the region. He's always got that tilted head, perplexed look on his face, like you're dog when he reaches the perimeter line of the invisible fence and catches a little testicular zap. Gaddafi's always wearing that dim sum steamer hat, trying to pass himself off at security checkpoints as Stuart Margolin from the Rockford Files, making a few bucks doing puppet shows for the kids. Did the measles scare you? The measles scared me! Who else we got over there? Saudi Arabia? Anybody trust these cats? You know, one of my dearest friends in the world is from Saudi Arabia, but I think the Saud royal family has turned that place into the hypotenuse in an asshole triangle with Iraq and Iran. They're just a bunch of transparent suck-ups. They're like the Eddie Haskell of the Mideast. Gee, you look beautiful this morning, President Cleaver. Israel versus the Palestinians, is this one fixable? Probably not. I might be out here in the cheap seats of the diaspora, but from where I'm sitting, it looks completely unsolvable. I mean, is it possible to miss the point any more than having the shootout at Christ's manger? Does that not send up a big red flag when you find yourself doing that Starsky and Hutch shoulder roll behind the frankincense decanter that the Magi have left behind? This is the gunfight at the Oy Vey Corral. You know, I find Yasser Arafat to be an enigma. Ostensibly, he's one of the world's most dangerous men, yet it would appear at any given moment, if he wishes to do so, Ariel Sharon can give him a timeout. Young man, you go to what's left of your room in Ramallah right now. My wife helped me with that joke. I was saying grounded. She said, honey, that's ancient terminology. It's timeout, so thank you, baby, for the help. You know, other than the bombs they strap to their chest, I have absolutely no idea what makes the Palestinians tick. I do know that, a lot of them are killing themselves. They all want to get ahead to the lightning round, and I was thinking, what is that about? It must have something to do with the 72 virgins that they're promised in the next life. And you know something? That might sound good, but is that really that good a proposition? 7 or 8 virgins, yeah, it's probably fun. You get around 10 virgins in, I'm thinking you're gonna want a pro. You know, I like the befuddled thing as much as the next guy up front. Somewhere during the evening, I want a finger jammed up my ass. My wife did not help me with that show. What can we do to placate the Palestinians? How can we ameliorate the situation over there? Is there a historical precedent for a group of people who feel they've been jobbed of their land by a Johnny-come-lately? I, in the strictest Swiftian sense of the word, have a modest proposal. I'm not saying it'll work, but nothing else seems to have worked. I say that we give the Palestinians the casinos, because, seems to have cooled the Indians out. You know, they're already pre-named, the sands, the dunes, the desert inn. Who else we got over there? Afghanistan remains the demented moonscape it's always been. Topographically speaking, it makes your cat's litter box look like Monet's garden at Giverny. My favorite Afghanistan war story is the Al-Qaeda fighter who is crushed to death by the descending humanitarian food pallet. Oh, sweet irony. Everybody's sitting around in the next life at the psycho Algonquin kicking it around. What happened to you, Khalid? I saw a shadow, looked up, Del Monte Kling Peach is coming right in my head. Unbelievable. Silly me, I rushed out of the hovel that morning. I didn't even have my Kevlar turban on. I think these people hate us because of our architecture. Every time I see Afghanistan on TV, there are like 4 walls left in the country. All of them have bad despot du jour Dirk Diggler portraits on them. Conversely, they see our walls. Every wall we have has an ATM machine in it. Our walls literally shit money. Which brings us to Iraq. Now, say this about Iraq. They're old school insane. They have decided to steer into the crazy skid. And that's why they're the Vegas odds-on favorite to next be shit-hammered. I view Iraq as East Korea, because I think this war is to get the attention of North Korea. I think this is solely for the edification of Kim Jong-il and his Kim Jong-ilk. It's sort of like a shoot-your-cuffs war. I think that sand and heat make glass, and when we're done with Iraq, it should look like Superman's dad's apartment on Krypton. You know. Then you look over at North Korea, you go, hey man, you really want a piece of this motherfucker? And Kim Jong-il's the one we gotta worry about. You know he's a bad guy, huh? You don't usually get to lead up a country when you look that freaky. What is that about? You know, Ray Harryhausen has won technical achievement Oscars for creating creatures that look like Kim Jong-il. It's like the Buddy Holly of the Pan-Pacific Rim or something. It's with the hair. He looks like a Chia dictator, you know something? I hope when somebody eventually blows that head off, they have the good sense to put it in a jar and bring it home, because I know I'd pay a nickel to see that up close in a tent. That's like Dillinger's cock or something. I think I figured out a way to beat the North Koreans, too. I think we can get them when they're marching. Get them when that leg's up in the air. Huh? Yeah, I think they're vulnerable right then. You perfect some sort of groin laser when they're doing their rocket show. You just sever that there, get it flapping like a broken window shade. They fall to the ground, they're helpless. You know their dogs aren't gonna help them, because all that man's best friend shit goes out the window once they put you on the menu. Their dogs are our secret weapon. Those hounds have been laying in wait for years for this overthrow. Paybacks are a bitch. In this case, literally. So there you have it. What better place for a dry run than the desert? Not only should we invade Iraq, we should put it on pay-per-view and sell bobblehead dolls. I mean, if only we could get Sean Penn on board, huh? Jeez, if only Saddam Hussein was a paparazzi. You know, Sean's one of those interesting Hollywood dichotomies that when I eventually cross his path now, he'll want to beat my ass because I insinuated that he wasn't peaceful. Oh, well, dead career walking, huh? Unfortunately, I think George's old man dropped the ball on this around 12 years ago. We were two exits away on the Jersey Turnpike from croaking this toad, and yet we back off because we don't have the green light from the coalition. The coalition? Are you shitting me? You know, Tony Blair's a cute kid, and he's my favorite Martin Short character in waiting, but quite frankly, I haven't cleared things with the Brits since our boys dressed up like the Hakawi and boosted all the Tetley into Beantown Harbor during Strom Thurmond's second term, all right? You know, on the domestic front, I think our reaction to 9/11 has been amazingly nonchalant. You know, I think Tom Ridge is a good man. I admire his service in the NOM, but that terrorist mood ring's just not gonna be enough. I think the worst mistake the Al-Qaeda ever made is when they gassed that puppy on videotape and ran it on CNN, because that got the liberals into the fray. Guys looking up from their Marmaduke day planners, what's that? They killed a puppy. Well, now it's on, motherfucker, now. Think they have a lottery to determine which dogs are going to be bomb-sniffing dogs and which are going to be drug-sniffing dogs? Is that a tense day for a pooch? What'd you get, Toby? Shit, bombs. Bombs. I was on eBay the other day. I saw a series of crushed black velvet paintings of drug-sniffing dogs playing poker, and it was pretty sad. They had a little shih tzu completely baked on PCP. Kept overbedding, low pairs. You hate to see it. Profiling? Are you kidding me? You know, folks, when 15 out of 19 people are from one country, and you happen to notice that, that's not profiling. That's minimally observant, okay? If I'm ever on an airplane, If I'm ever on an airplane and a guy who looks like that shoe bomber sits down next to me, I'm going to call the stewardess over and say, excuse me, honey, but if this fucker isn't the harmonica player for the J. Giles band, I want him off the plane right now, okay? Yeah. This had better be Jeff Goldblum on a 3-day meth bender. Because I don't trust anybody in Converse black high tops who isn't playing small forward for the 64 Celtics. You know, the shoe bomber's so ugly, he's not going to get fucked in jail. But the ACLU will fight for his right to party, won't they? Huh? Because they don't have any common sense anymore. They think common sense is common. I noticed during the last Christmas season, the big agenda was to do away with public nativity scenes. Yeah, that's what's wrong with America right now. Plastic depictions of the birth of Christ. You know, the ACLU is now degenerated to the point where they'll fight against your right to erect a public nativity scene, but they'll fight for the right of the local stoner who wants to stumble into the scene and fuck one of the sheep in the ass. Now the ACLU is helping to fight overturn a Mississippi state law that prohibits homosexuals from adopting children. You know, folks, I'm no expert on the subject, but if you're gay and you've chosen to set up shop in Mississippi, even I'm reasonably sure you're not equipped to adopt children, okay? What are you working that big glory hole scene down in Pascagoula? Jimmy, fire up the El Camino, man. There's a circle jerk in Hattiesburg. Yeah, leave the right shoulder strap on your bib overalls unclipped. It's code for pitcher. Yeah, all the weird stuff comes out of Mississippi. Now they don't want to take the part of their flag, their state flag, as a partial depiction of the Confederate flag, and they don't want to take it down from over the state capitol. They say that it's not a racist emblem, but merely reflects a quaint time in their great state's history. Yeah, right. And you know, the swastika is just a plus sign doing cartwheels. ACLU lawyers sit around all day in the self-righteous ether, waiting for the precise instant that the atrocity alarm goes off. Then it's right down the fire pole, into their Basswegians, out the front door to provide immediate aid to the worst humanity has to offer, gallingly, all in the name of humanity. And you know, the worst thing is when they tell me to lead my life exactly as I did prior to 9/11. You want to know something, folks? Truth be told, I hated insane foreign assholes who wanted to kill me on September 10th of that year, okay? This is no big stretch for me. And then they always bring up our founding fathers and say, you shouldn't be so uptight, man. Our founding fathers were civil libertarians. Oh, for God's sakes. Do you think our founding fathers would have put up with any of this shit? They were blowing people's heads off because they put a tax on their breakfast beverage. And you know, it wasn't even coffee. Can you imagine how batshit these guys would have been had they been on a 4-shot espresso? Now, let me get this straight. We don't hate people who want to kill us anymore? Did I miss a meeting? Well, you know, we got to get our game face on here. These guys are into it completely. There are no Al-Qaedas, okay? And if we're not going to go sling blade on these assholes, somebody tell me, because I'm going to go live in Alec Baldwinia, all right? Folks, it is time for a good old-fashioned American yeehaw. Thank you, sister, and amen. I don't like the fact that we get 5% of our oil from Saddam Hussein. Is that unbelievable? That just blows my mind. What about Alaska? Are we just never going to do anything with Alaska, ever? Just tell me. I'll go along with everybody, but nothing ever? We got it for like $4 in Mallow Cup money. The Ruskies were in yet another vodka stupor. They had no idea what they were giving up. We even called it Seward's Folly. You know, all of a sudden it's Valhalla. Why is that? Because the caribou are there? The caribou? I didn't even know what it was. I had the research, and a caribou is a large North American reindeer. He's a reindeer who couldn't make the show. Yet somehow they've managed to get their own state. It's textbook passive-aggressive behavior. They just nibble on that berry and give you that fern gully look, start batting their eyes, play the species card on you. Oh, don't hurt me, evil biped. And we give them Alaska. We only have 50 states. We've given one to a herd of Simu bullwinkles. What's up with nature? Why so whiny? Why so soft? No snowmobiles in Yellowstone Park now? I mean, for God's sakes, what are we supposed to do with nature? Just look at it? What is it, like porn with leaves? Where's this delicate balance of nature I always hear so much about? Every time I watch Animal Planet, there's some rabid harp seal chucking penguins down his gullet like they were maitre d' Tic Tacs, you know? To me, nature always appears more unbalanced than Nick Nolte with a clogged eustachian tube. Global warming? Well, listen, this sounded legit to me, so I thought I'd best do some research. I don't want to piss away on this one until I know what's up. I've got kids. Now, there's a lot of differing data, but as far as I can gather, the crux of it is over the last 100 years, the temperature of this planet has gone up 1.8 degrees. Am I the only one who finds that amazingly stable? You know, I'm always amazed, as per chaos theory, I don't wake up one morning and it's 3,000 degrees, and I'm just a big Kingsford briquette and a pair of jammies. 1.8? Are you kidding me? I could go back to my hotel room tonight and futz with a thermostat for the next 3 or 4 hours. I could not detect that difference. You know, I'm kind of glad it went up. I'm always a little chilly anyway. And you know, the money I'm saving on sweaters, I put into a cookie jar to buy a 30-06 to blow a caribou's head off with. It's the circle of life, Simba. But environmentalists, they don't want to hear it. They get really cranky. They'll give you that guilt card. Well, what about your kids? Of course I love my kids. I hope they live to be 100. It's another 1.8. And they give you, what about your kids' kids? 3.6. I'll just tell them we moved to Phoenix or something. Then they get really crazy on you. Well, what about your kids? You know, I'm never going to meet them. I'd like to tell you they matter, but they don't. You get around 4 kids out there, I don't give a shit anymore. I assume I had relatives thousands of years ago, could care less about me. Well, should I leave the cave today and use a blunt instrument to kill a mastodon and procure some meat, or should I get ready for Dennis's arrival in the mid-1900s? Wilma, what time's this flight getting in, honey? I think, Al Gore's an environmentalist, and I think he'll have a lot more time to work on it now, it would appear, huh? Yeah, seems like a decent man, but he was tough to watch, you gotta admit. I know psoriasis sufferers who are more comfortable in their own skin than Al Gore. You know, this guy's inner circle was square. And I'll tell you what I didn't like. I didn't like his take on education. I think he's a lapdog for the teachers' union. I mean, you know, we've got some serious educational problems in this country, and I thought his aversion to get behind school vouchers was the talcum powder in the air that exposed his true laser. Now, I should tell you, by way of biographical information, I was homeschooled, oddly enough, at a branch campus. But I do know this about education. Liberals don't want you to be able to help yourself vis-a-vis education, because that would preclude them from being the ones to do the helping. And Munchausen by proxy disease doesn't get any more proxy than that, my friends. You know something? We've got some serious problems we're gonna have to face up to in this country, and we just can't throw academic happy talk and platitudes at them. We do need some testing, for God's sakes, to stay on top of people, but they don't wanna hear it. Oh, Dennis, don't be so uptight. Come on, man, forget grades. Grades don't matter. D's are just B's without their belt on. Yeah. That's how you end up at age 45 in a paper hat saying, you want something to brink with that Big Mac? A late arriving crowd. Now they want to take dodgeball out of the schools, for God's sakes. They don't want to impinge on anybody's sensitivities. Do you really want to send your kids out into the shitstorm that is adult life completely unprepared? Isn't life pretty much one big protracted 75-year episode of getting hit in the balls with one thing or another? I think teachers and lawyers should flip salaries. You know, I think that better yet, I think teachers should take on students on a contingency basis where they earn an eventual percentage of the child's adult earnings. This would certainly light a fire under a teacher's ass to stress the basics. And we need to return to the basics in this country when you stop to think that only one of the three R's actually starts with the letter R. But liberals don't want to lean on anybody. They think that makes them good guys, I guess. But I don't know. Isn't one of the most denigrating things you can do to another human being is have absolutely no expectations of them? And I don't think some of these liberal heroes are the proletariat wunderkind they paint themselves to be. I've got to watch the senior Democratic senator from the great state of West Virginia, this old moron Robert Byrd, stand there in the well of the Senate and lecture me on morality and ethics. Earlier in his life, this guy was in the Ku Klux Klan. Robert Byrd is foghorn leg iron. You know something? It is a sickness to want to hear the sound of your own voice as much as he does. It's avuncular sclerosis. Robert Byrd's head is so far up his ass, they're going to have to cut in switchback trails to get to it. And it's not just him. Most politicians are stiff. Let's face facts. Congress is just a place where we send mediocre men to be Earl-shibed into looking kind of vaguely consequential, and politics is just in a bullshit world where my esteemed colleague means this prick here. I like Bush because he's not Bill Clinton. You know, every time I see those Now that surprises me in Chicago. But every time I see those kids playing t-ball on the White House lawn, on the field that George Bush built for them, he sits there with that hat on, and I think about his predecessor running around like some demented Groucho with a Cohiba in one hand and his al dente Schwantz in the other. At the very least, I just want to thank George Bush for allowing me to respect the American presidency again. You know, Was Bill Clinton popular? Yes, of course he was popular. I sometimes think his popularity was just the unfortunate byproduct of the diminished expectations of an off-the-rack culture. But he was popular, but it's time for him to go away now as we go to war. He and his wife will just not shut the fuck up. And she never has an original thought. He says it. 4 days later, she parrots it. And I think the reason that Hillary Clinton is so comfortable riding on Bill Clinton's coattails is because she's well aware of the fact that there's frequently no room available on the front of the garment. I'll tell you one thing I like about Bush. He might not be known as an environmentalist, but his ranch always looks real nice on TV. Everybody should take care of their own, huh? I like Dick Cheney, too. And I'll tell you something. I like Cheney because I like the fact he made some money in the real world. When did that become a sin? Are we supposed to pick all the people who are fuck-ups in the real world and let them be our leader? Huh? Here, you couldn't get it together out there. Come in and lead me. I don't think Cheney's going to see this second term, though. I mean, I think he'll be alive. I just think he might have to drop out. It's too arduous. He's got the Philo Doe ticker, and I'm thinking maybe he steps down, goes on the road, starts performing the angina monologues. Cheney's like Yoda with a goiter. And you know something? That last Star Wars film sucked, but Yoda threw down, didn't he, huh? Little man came out of the corner with that laser sword like he had the only lighter in a crack house. Dick Cheney is a barely controlled burn that could jump the fire road at any given moment. He always has that look on his face like, "No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die." I was thinking, where have I seen that look before? And it's Alan Greenspan when he has to testify before the House committee. And Sonny Bono's widow, Mary Bono, stumbles through an amazingly convoluted question off a 3x5 card. Takes her forever to get through it. She gets to the end of it. Greenspan has those half glasses down at the tip of his nose. You can almost hear him thinking, "Excuse me, the fuck is going on here? I'm Alan fucking Greenspan. I studied, for Christ's sake. You married Sonny Bono. You're not gonna understand this answer. Sonny barely got it. Sort of fucking cosmic bunny hole have I fallen through here?" You know, fiscally, we're getting double-donged in this culture. We're getting taxed way too high, and they don't even spend it effectively. And I'm getting sick of the left telling me what a fuck-up I am, and in the next breath demanding 48% of my fucked-upness, okay? How's about the courtesy of a reach-around, guys? And if you want to see what untethered liberalism does, look no further than my home state of delirium. Oh, excuse me, California. Where it's no longer the San Andreas fault, but now it's Gray Davis's fault. We are buying energy at minibar prices. You know what, folks? It's maddening. We're just not using our heads anymore. Our legal system has more holes in it than a thing that is completely and utterly riddled with holes. Sorry, the metaphor well went dry around 3:30 this afternoon. I cranked the little bucket up. Empty. You know, we now want to label Big Macs, but we're loath to label child molesters. What's with these lawsuits against fast food companies? I assume most of us know that it's shit. That's why we like it. What is this urge for the country to be uniformly fit? You know, the last time I remember that happening was Germany in the mid to late 30s, and that didn't really work out too well, did it? Come on. To me, fat guys are the chirping canary in the mine shaft of freedom. Now a group of overweight Americans wants to file a lawsuit against the big three automakers. They say the seatbelts in the car won't fit around their waist and it puts them in harm's way. Oh, for Christ's sake. You know, if you can't fit the seatbelt in a car around your waist, a head-on collision is like the least of your health concerns, all right? Why don't we just fill the airbags with a soft, edible nougatine material so you can snack your way out of the fucking wreck, okay? How's that, Tarkus? You know, Shakespeare said, first kill all the lawyers, and I've been doing some thinking. And I think we could get away with it. Because if we killed all of them at our murder trial, we wouldn't have adequate representation in the eyes of the court. Just something to think about. But lawyers are only the second biggest problem in this country. The biggest problem is this misguided urge we all have, and I'm sure it comes from a good place, though, but it's wrong, to change each other's mind on the most cosmic, intricate issues of the day. Now, growing up, my family was not very tight. We were more like a tour group with secrets. But I will tell you that... We were taught to keep our noses out of other people's business. And there's not a premium placed on that in this culture anymore. There are people who define themselves in America now solely through agitation. They have no life except yours. So they presume to get involved. And presumption begat advocacy, and advocacy begat political correctness. And political correctness is just inverted McCarthyism. And believe me, I don't throw the word McCarthyism around lightly, because I just saw St. Elmo's Fire again on TV the other night, and I was reminded how truly god-awful he was in that. But somebody's got to say this stuff, so here goes. Now, I think alcoholism is a disease. It's a great fucking disease. If you got to get a disease, you should hit your knees and pray to God you get alcoholism. Because even when you have a relapse, it's kind of fun. What's up with you, Skeeter? You look all happy. Yeah, man, I got my disease again. I'm riddled with it, brother. I'm going to heal up tomorrow. You want to do some therapeutic jello shots with me? What else has been bugging me? Barbara Streisand, huh? You know what Barbara Streisand's problem is? She thinks she's Barbara Streisand. She's been shot with magic hour lighting in films for so long, now she's actually starting to see the world that way. And you know, I just tend to tune somebody out after their seventh or eighth retirement concert. I mean, for God's sakes, her husband does muffler commercials. Can't he bring one home and strap it on the old lady's pie hole? Next up, I believe in preemptive force right now because we live in a dangerous world. It's no longer the sword of Damocles hanging over our head. It's the ICBM of Damocles. Now, does that mean I like war? Of course I don't. That's so simplistic. I hate war like everybody else. I guess I like war about as much as most pro-choice advocates like abortion. It's an unfortunate reality of life. There, if that helps you to get your head around it, don't think of it as a war. Think of it as choosing to abort Saddam Hussein. And you know something? I'm not saying we should be trigger happy right now, but certainly we shouldn't be all that trigger sad either. I mean, who's going to protect us? Which of our allies? The Germans? Well, you never know why the Germans don't sign on, if they don't agree with the war, or it's just not on a grand enough scale for them. The Russians? Putin's hands are tied right now after that disaster with the nerve gas in Moscow. He can't do anything right now. Christ's sake. And if you stop to think about it, guys can kill that many friendlies liberating an opera house. You really want them flying right off your wing anyway? And that brings us to the French. And I will say this to the frogs. You might as well gas up the dinghy and go fishing with Fredo, because you are dead to me, okay? You know something? These cats are now putting swastikas on our flags over there. And after we had the good taste to chisel off all the armpit hair before we erected the Statue of Liberty in New York Harbor. You know, I always thought the reason it was tinted green was because of the oxidized copper. Little did I realize it was all envy, huh? You know, folks, the French have always been reluctant to surrender to the wishes of their friends and almost anticipatory in their urge to surrender to the wishes of their enemies. And I'll tell you one thing, when the war train pulls out this time, they should not be allowed back on. I would say to them, listen, guys, you don't want to fight, you're stuck on the platform. You want to get your hands dirty now? You're just going to have to run them through your own hair, okay? And you know something? Everybody's always worried about post-liberation Iraq and who's going to take care of it. Well, I think this will figure itself out. I think we're going to get in there. I think we're going to find some dirty paper on reactor parts, some oil deals, and I think we're going to have it over the French. And that's when you make the call and say, listen, you didn't want to fight? Guess what? You're in charge of the day-to-day needs of the noble Iraqi now. I think concierge is a French word, isn't it? And you know, if they keep busting our balls, maybe we should just invade Iraq and then invade Chirac. Run an oil pipeline from the fields right over to the base of the Eiffel Tower, shoot it up through, you'll have the biggest oil derrick in the world. Just get Bush standing at the bottom in a cowboy hat with a lariat and a branding iron, putting a big W on Chirac's ass, it'll drive him up a fucking wall. You know? You know, I would call the French scumbags, but that, of course, would be a disservice to bags filled with scum. Who else are we going to depend on? The United Nations? Huh? The General Assembly? The slights of the round table? You only have to watch one UN session. It makes you want to prescribe Ritalin to a glacier. And you know something? Folks, we have to take care of ourselves right now because there is a competency chasm in this world and it is widening. We're getting it better what we do and the rest of the world is falling behind and they're going to hate us more and more for this. We are simultaneously the most hated, loved, feared, and admired nation on this planet. In short, we are Frank Sinatra. And the chairman didn't make his bones lying down for punks outside the Fontainebleau, okay? When were nuclear weapons taken off the table? What is this, like our mother's good China syndrome? We're just never gonna use them? And you know something? Don't say you're never gonna use it. What good does that do? You gotta act flaky about it. When they start all that shit, under what possible conditions would you ever even consider, possibly even consider using one of your nuclear weapons? You're gonna go Sean Spicoli on them and go, if we can't find the other ones? And you know something, if we are gonna act preemptively, I say we do it with those unmanned drones. We've got a great untapped resource in this country. I got a 12-year-old. You give him a Barca lounge or a bag of Doritos and a toggle switch, I guarantee you he'll fly one of those unmanned drones right up Hussein's ass. And he won't even wake him up till he detonates the motherfucker. What else is bothering me? Isn't it time to double-click the refresh icon on the Constitution? I mean, what else from 200 years ago is still applicable? If Gus Van Sant can remake Psycho, certainly we can polish up ye olde parchment. What do you still hold dear from way back then, huh? Churning butter, wooden ships to Europe, shitting outside in the winter? Nothing. Just the core document by which we govern our day-to-day lives. How do we even know we're interpreting it correctly? What if the right to bear arms means you can wear a sleeveless T-shirt? And you know, the National Rifle Association has got to quit jamming this armed militia clause down my throat. I don't want to do away with the guns, but I think I'm like most of you. We got to tighten it up a little. Let's at least make it as hard to get a gun license as it is to get a pilot's license. And you know something? If we can't agree on that, how's about this? You're not allowed to have more guns than you do teeth, okay? Would that be a good first step? Abortion. Now listen, I'm pro-choice on abortion, but as Roe v. Wade enters its 121st trimester, I think we've gotten a little abortion crazy in this country, and I'm just finding the word abortion so grim. Everybody leads their abortion, not abortion, abortion, abortion. I think we need a change in terminology, and I've been doing some thinking. Once again, I have an idea. I'm not saying it's a great one, we'll see you think. I don't say we call an abortion anymore. I think we should call it an ovarian mulligan. It just sounds happier, doesn't it? Where are you going, baby? I'm taking a mully. All right. We'll settle up at the turn. I know there's going to be a lot of labia rattling about this, but we got to do something. I saw a story on CNN about a woman in South America who just had her 23rd child. For Christ's sake, lady, it's a vagina, not a clown car, okay? And finally, I think liberal America really jumped the shark when they ruled the Pledge of Allegiance unconstitutional. And this was upheld again yesterday. You can now burn a flag in this country, but you cannot salute it while you burn it. Now, I haven't quite worked out the math on this one yet, but somewhere along the line, the oppressed minority in this country has become the majority. Well, you know something, if life is a gamble, it's time for the squares to take back the deal. That should be our vig for playing by the rules. Every jerk-off fringe dweller with an axe to grind now has his own star out on the dirty boulevard, and that's fine. Go ahead, knock yourself out, just don't bust my rice bowl, because I've chosen to lead a relatively normal life. You know, we don't have to love one another, folks. We don't even have to like one another. But we do have to respect each other, at least as much as we would seem to respect the caribou. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Thinking about the times you took.